So causal effects may differ from person to person because people are different. So what that means is there's a distribution of causal effects in the population. So some people may have a positive effect, some people may have a negative effect. Now, the best case scenario for learning about causality is that we learn the unit level causal effects for every single person. Okay? So for example, if you go to the doctor, you have some problem, he's got a medication he can give you. If he knows your unit level effect, he'll give you the medication. If it's positive, he won't give it to you if it's negative. We could make individual treatment decisions perfectly based on everybody's unit level causal effect. Okay? Now, if we knew the distribution of causal effects, meaning we know every causal effect for everybody, we could learn a bunch of interesting numbers, like the percentage of people who have positive treatment effect. Okay? That would say how many people benefit from having Medicaid, for example, or how many people benefit from a particular drug. Okay. Now, as I've mentioned before, the problem is we fundamentally cannot learn unit level causal effects because we don't see the same person both having treatment and not having treatment. So typically, trying to learn the unit level causal effect for everybody is just out of the question. So we just can't do it. Now, even learning about the distribution of causal effects, which says, you know, maybe we don't know exactly who has the positive effect, who has the negative effect, but we know that most people have a positive effect, for example. That's also often too much to ask for and very difficult to get. It can be done, but it typically requires many assumptions and is difficult to do. So what people often settle for is something called the average treatment effect, okay? The average treatment effect is simply you take everybody in the population, all your people, and you look at their unit level causal effects, okay? That's a number. You write it down on a list. You do that for everybody, and then you just take the average of all of those numbers. That's the average effect. Now, that's sometimes a good summary of the overall effect of treatment, but sometimes looking at just averages isn't necessarily a good thing. So, for example, here I've got this comic for an app called Tornado Guard. Okay, what does this app do? Well, it plays a loud alert sound when there is a tornado warning in your area. Okay, well, the average star rating, 4 stars out of 5. Looks pretty good. But let's look at the distribution of star ratings. Well, the first guy says 5 stars. Good user interface. Many alert choices. That's nice. Second person says 5 stars. Runs great. Doesn't crash. Pretty good. Third person says 5 stars. I like how you can set it to multiple locations. Okay. Fourth person, 1 star. App did not warn me about tornado. So in some cases, you don't necessarily want to be satisfied with the average. You want to know things about the distribution or the extremes, the maximum causal effect, the minimum causal effect, okay? But those are more difficult to get to than the average, so that's why we're going to start from there, okay? So let's think about average treatment effects. So say we treat everybody, okay? We give everybody Medicaid. Then we're going to observe everyone's outcome under the treatment. Okay, so we observe everybody's cholesterol when they have Medicaid. Now, the average of everybody's outcome in that case is called the average outcome under the policy. Okay, now suppose we do the opposite. Okay, here we're just doing a hypothetical to get a better understanding of what this definition is. Okay, so suppose that we didn't treat anybody, we don't give anybody Medicaid. Okay. Then we observe their outcomes. We observe cholesterol for everybody. And we just take the average cholesterol. Well, that average is called the average outcome without the policy. And the average treatment effect is just the difference between the average outcome under the policy and the average outcome without the policy. Okay? That's it. That's all it is. And that actually is equivalent to the definition I gave earlier, that you take the individual unit causal effects, okay, and you just write them down for every person, and then you take the average of that. That also will give you the average treatment effect, okay? So let's suppose that larger values are better of the outcome, okay? So for example, GDP, you know, let's just suppose that we want more GDP, okay? Then a typical interpretation of the average treatment effect is that a positive average treatment effect means that the policy is good. It means that on average, the treatment effects increase outcomes, okay? Because remember, the average treatment effect is the difference between the average with the policy and the average without the policy. So if that difference is positive, it means that outcomes are larger on average with the policy than they are without the policy, okay? So if bigger outcomes are better, then a positive average treatment effect means the policy is good. And conversely, a negative average treatment effect means the policy is bad. And a zero or very close to zero average treatment effect means the policy has no effect. Okay? That's the typical interpretation for the average treatment effect. But remember what I mentioned earlier, okay? It's an average. So everyone has a different treatment effect. Some people are positive, some people are negative, possibly. Maybe everyone's positive, that would be nice. So these distributional features we should also keep in mind, okay? But as I said, that's difficult to get, so that's why people often focus on the average treatment effect.